Are you singing a different tune in God's orchestra? Good morning, everyone. This is our reflection question for today. At a meeting of the American Psychological Association, Jack Clifton, a psychologist at Union College, and R. Scott Bulioni, a graduate student at Columbia University, presented their findings on how members of the various sections of 11 major symphony orchestras perceived each other. The percussionists were viewed as insensitive, unintelligent, and hard of hearing, yet fun-loving. String players were seen as arrogant, stuffy, and unathletic. The orchestra members overwhelmingly chose loud as the primary adjective to describe the brass players. Woodwind players seemed to be held in the highest esteem, described as quiet and meticulous, though a bit egotistical. Interesting findings, to say the least. With such widely divergent personalities and perceptions, how could an orchestra ever come together to make such wonderful music? The answer is simple. Regardless of how those musicians view each other, they subordinate their feelings and biases to the leadership of the conductor. Under his guidance, they play beautiful music. In today's first reading, St. Paul talks about how we are all different parts of the body of Christ, different in talents, skills, and temperament, but all working to build up his kingdom. In the last few days, St. Paul has been teaching about unity. He has seen how the local churches he has established in the areas he went to have had their leaders disagreeing, fighting, and forming factions. He knows that one of the birth pains of change, because his teachings are new and radical, about a man of simple origins taking the world of that time by storm, is disunity. How familiar, isn't it? We are all different, but complementary. And yet we fail to recognize that in diversity, there can be unity. We have our talents and strengths that will help prosper our parish, our spiritual community, our Catholic Church. Our architects build our beautiful churches and offices. Our corporate managers put systems and processes in place. Our lawyers keep us straight and compliant. Our doctors provide us with bodily health. Our priests give us food for the soul. A basic question we need to reflect on is, am I grateful enough that I must offer myself wholeheartedly to build God's kingdom? If the answer is yes, we must serve, determined to rid ourselves of attitudes and behaviors that might destroy the kingdom of God and lead to our own spiritual destruction. First, we must guard against being disrespectful of others. We need to respect different viewpoints and appreciate the diversity of ideas, for they contribute to the richness of our faith. There is no one who has a monopoly of intelligence and brilliance. Second, we must avoid being imperious or arrogant. What good is our intelligence and our wealth if we are not able to love our team members? It would be a travesty if we are filled with bitterness and resentment, unforgiveness and hardness of heart. Third, we must not allow ourselves to be envious. We must wire our minds and our hearts to all work and worship together. We must honor and affirm one another. We are all important parts of our well-oiled faith community. Our role is important, no matter how small we think it is. There are no big or small roles. Every role contributes to the vibrancy of our church. In March 1981, President Reagan was shot by John Hinckley Jr. and was hospitalized for several weeks. Although Reagan was the nation's chief executive, his hospitalization had little impact on the nation's activity. Government continued on. On the other hand, suppose the garbage collectors in this country went on strike, as they did not long ago in Philadelphia. That city was not only in a literal mess. The pile of decaying trash quickly became a health hazard. A three-week nationwide strike would paralyze the country. Who is more important, the president or a garbage collector? In the body of Christ, seemingly insignificant ones are urgently needed. As Paul reminds us, the head cannot say to the feet, "I don't need you." On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. Fourth, we must not be selfish. Our talents and our resources are not ours to keep, but must be shared. We must be joyful in serving together. We share in the hard work of hurdling the challenges of serving and loving to build our Catholic Church. We are Team Christ, not a team bringing crisis to itself. We are not together to break up our togetherness, Our ally is Jesus and not Satan. If we are the source of disunity because we are disrespectful, imperious, envious, and selfish, D-I-E-S or dies, we will feel the burden of our pettiness and callousness through sleepless nights and continuous nightmares. Our faith dies, and with it, our joy. We need to ask the Holy Spirit for the grace to repent in order to be saved. Today's gospel precisely tells us to do so. Jesus calls us to repentance for our sins that lead us to hate and not to love. We should not put off this decision to follow God's greatest commandment. For if we love one another, we are in fact loving God. Even if we are so different from one another, we can all play harmonious music together if we allow ourselves to be led by the greatest conductor himself. In loving one another, we play beautiful music together. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, teach me to love so that I may find joy in serving you through others. This I pray in Jesus' holy and mighty name. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless your families, brothers and sisters. God bless our Catholic faith and Couples for Christ.